Chapter 6, Traditional Values Worldview. There are too many thoughts to follow, but I kept them all because that's how my brain works, and their interconnectedness, though frustratingly scatterbrained, all contribute to Chapter 6, the crux of this album. If any chapter reflects the meat of that to which it contributes, Traditional Values Worldview is that cut of correspondence. I suppose it's my rebellion against a dualism, a moralistic therapeutic deism, something with which I found myself relating to and rallying against as I heard it explained in words I'd never been able to articulate. Here I return to the Inter-Arts Fellowship lectures, where Timothy Keller describes the idea as such. Most Christians don't adopt a Christian worldview. They adopt a traditional values worldview, which is this. The problem with the world lies in bad, undisciplined, selfish people who won't submit to traditional moral values, and the solution is a moral revival. Get back to the roots of Western civilization, make the family system central again. Though I've come to land in different places than my parents throughout the years as far as what kinds of things Christians have the freedom to participate in, I don't think that either of them actually believed in that type of salvific family system. My dad's upbringing was an utter nightmare, and the only hope he had was found in a psalm I read this morning. God sets the lonely in families. My mom came from more of a conservative home, and even though both preceding generations were dittoheads who rarely missed a nightly news with Bill O'Reilly, none of them would have proclaimed political liberalism an unforgivable sin from which there was no turning back. Although it would have been a sin, to be sure. But of course, there had to be a reason for the proclaimed artistic gospel freedom to resonate so deeply within me as something that I did not have but longed after. It is difficult to articulate that reason. I know bits and pieces of it. I know that when I felt the freedom to do with this story is not a freedom I felt growing up beneath what I perceived to be the heavy-handed law of Christian media reviews, where whistleblowers shrieked at sex and alcohol and expletives, and no film or album got anything higher than a 2 out of 10 rating unless it was animated or had an altar call built into its end. And they all came with Christian alternative lists attached. Do your kids listen to Limp Bizkit? Then they'll love Thousand Foot Crutch. To be fair, though, that is why I love TFK's Set It Off. When Puppet dropped, I thought, finally, a Fred Durst my mom will actually let me listen to. But on this side of adulthood, am I to lay blame on a person, let alone my parents, intent on the practical purpose of helping navigate cultural waters for their children? In the end, we can stand divided on how to engage those waters, but 10 years removed from those authorities, I won't vilify them for their intent to help people make wise choices for the sake of holiness. Perhaps their work calls for more of my appreciation than my bitterness. You can only point fingers for so long. However, that doesn't mean that I agree with the type of separatism I perceived, nor that I think anyone is helped by defining themselves more by what they are against than simply who they are. And I certainly don't think that creating knockoff versions of secular art does anything for the Christian cause, nor do I think that Christianity is definitively causal. Years back, I remember Jesse Bryan and Invisible Creatures Don Clark giving a presentation called Why Jesus Creates Art, where Jesse started flipping out about Christian substitutes, yelling about Reese's Candy logos horribly rebranded to say, Jesus saves, and rebuking the Christian community's abhorrent practice of stealing originality in the name of redemption. I actually thought his head was going to explode. I can't stand it either. So perhaps that was one half of my newfound freedom, that I didn't have to feel guilty for not listening to crappy music even though all of the good music didn't say Jesus in it enough times. If there are three negatives in a sentence, does that cancel out the doubles? But I think I already knew that. It's cliche nowadays, anyway. At this point, if you're not listening to better music, then you just like bad music, and that's okay, and you're forgiven for your sins like the rest of us. But I think the main cry and motivation of this song is that Christianity is not the equivalent of separatism. When we're introduced to the mystic, She's torn in two by the low-hanging fog, desperate for holiness but condemned by her desires, begging the children to separate to find their true worth. Separate from body, separate from material, separate from economy, separate from culture. Separate. Separate. And here, in the name of holiness, is a lie. A lie that says you would be more clean to remove yourself from those people, from these people, from that situation, from that association. A lie that says separate because separation is exactly what the liar wants from you. Absence, so that he may go on doing what he does uninterrupted. The same kind of ridiculous mentality that says your marriage is more holy through continued abstinence after saying, I do. You can find that article link in the written commentary. Than it would be for you to hurry up and do. It is don'ts and sticks, and if you mind, you get carrots. Which is religion. But not true religion. Not truth. As long as Christians fail to repent of self-righteousness, we will continue to speak of evangelism in terms such as outreach, which implies we will not embrace lost people, but will keep them at least an arm's length away. Jesus was not a separatist, and he is our only righteousness. That quote comes from a book that Mark Driscoll wrote in 2004. Whatever irony reeks from its characters 10 years removed, I continue to return to the statement, partially because I'm a Vineyard Calvary Chapel kid grown up beneath a man saved during the Jesus movement by their outreach, and partially because I like shocking statements, and Mark's always been a shock jock at heart. The point is, I serve a Jesus who not only entered the pain and suffering of this world, but he swallowed the excrement caked thick in my filthy heart, and I know that if his hands absorbed the sins committed by mine, they were dirty. He came as the God-man, unafraid, for the least and worst, and you and me. I don't think that Jesus is afraid of our calling things the way that we see them. They might not be the way he sees them, but I think that he probably cares for pretense even less than inaccuracy. He would rather change us than have us act as though we were changed already, rather heal the sick than have the sick pretend to be healed. I don't think he has any issues with us desiring the things that we desire, as he is creator of those desires. I don't think that he condemns interacting with those desires, broken, either. And so I think that writers can write about them, and singers can sing about them, and hopefully Christians can be image bearers, however broken, who are free to exist closely enough to others that they can observe us imaging God before their very eyes. All I'm saying is that I don't think we image him well by disengaging. I don't think that we image him well by calling dirty what he has called clean. I return to the Inner Arts lecture here with a quote from philosopher Al Walters. As far as I can tell, the Bible is absolutely unique in its rejection of all attempts to either demonize some part of creation as the root of our problems, or idolize some part as the solution. All other religions, philosophies, worldviews, in one way or another, fall into the trap of idolatry, failing to keep creation and fall distinct. Keller expounds, only the Christian worldview locates the problem of the world not in a part of the world, or a people of the world, but sin, which means sin infects us all. We can't divide the world into good guys and bad guys. Without understanding the nature of the kingdom, we are going to be naively utopian or cynical or disillusioned altogether. Total depravity doesn't mean that everybody is as sinful as they could possibly be, but that if sin was blue, everybody would be blue all over. Your reason would not be less blue than your emotions. Your body would not be less blue than your spirit. The normal, day-to-day world would not be less blue than the church. Christian writers can constantly deconstruct things. The tool is this. If you make anything but God the Savior, and anything but sin the demon, it creates all kinds of problems. I honestly think that the Christian secular adjective distinctions are a problem. Not because faith isn't practical and can't clearly look like something, but because the majority of our stamps of approval are based upon checklists that have far more to do with turning a house of prayer into a marketplace than they have anything to do with the grace of Jesus as we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And we have begun to define what makes a man's work acceptable according to how squeaky clean it is. And did you know that Pontius Pilate's hands were squeaky clean as well? I am not advocating for moral licentiousness. If grace becomes to us a license to sin, then we have misunderstood the cost of the cross. I am, however, advocating for reality, for authenticity, for truth. There's a reason people love the Bad Christian Podcast right now. Perhaps you, reader, would call that a poor example if I claim not to be one for license, but their popularity isn't all because it's cool to be edgy, but because people resonate with the voicing of thoughts that, right or wrong, are out in the open. And they can do it at the expense of others willing to take the risk of being cast out of whatever line we're all supposed to get into in order to advance to the next level of whatever game we're playing. There's a reason people break to pieces when they can't stack up against the weight of the law. It's what the law was designed for. Perhaps BC Pod is an extreme on the pendulum of what happens when people break, but I know that the better friend I become to Jesus, and I hope that I am becoming a better friend, the more I find myself completely messed up, not the other way around. Maybe that's not such bad company to be in. Even Paul's downward trajectory throughout his Christian life found him the least of the apostles, and then the least of all the saints, and finally, the chief of sinners. I wish I could tell the mystic in the story that we're all so messed up, but she was created with those desires for a reason. Not for penance and fragmentation, but as a whole, being holy unto a holy creator of them. Jack Kerouac said, "My fault, my failure, is not in the passions I have, but in my lack of control over them." Again, good things can become God things, but too many good things are called bad things. And perhaps more often than not, they need redemption and direction, but not casting out. But if they do need to be cast out, it will not happen through denouncing desire or our bootstraps. Thomas Chalmers said that even misplaced affections are only removed by the expulsive power of ones greater than they. I close with the thought that morality alone cannot equal Christian revival. It never worked revival in me. Indicative precedes imperative. Who we are influences what we do. Let there be morality, yes. Let there be sanctification. But let it come from a place of positional holiness gifted by the Christ who became sin so that we might become his righteousness. Christ who says, "It is finished," or "It's all done," like my own dad used to say. Christ who knows we still exist in the now and not yet, simultaneously saint and sinner, holy his and holy who he made us to be. For a reason.